Hello.
Are you the father of Daniel Avery?
I was walking the road to Santiago de Compostela, 800 kilometers on the northwestern coast of Spain. This is everything it had when we found it. People have walked the path for over 1,000 years. The way is a very personal journey, Mr. Avery.
Daniel was my only child. We're gonna walk the Camino to Santiago, both of us.
Come. This is the way.
So I know nothing about this film, except that it's Martin Sheen hanging out with a son that he hasn't disowned yet.
one thing I can tell you about this movie, The Way, if nothing else, it gets that damn fastball song stuck in your head and you can't get rid
of it. Just because
of
the title.
Yeah.
The song's not in the movie. I almost wish it was in the movie. Because I would have at least felt justified singing it all through the movie.
Meanwhile, right. There's kids out there like, we don't know what the fuck they're talking about.
Yeah.
The what?
I wasn't a top hit outside of Austin, you know. Just saying.
Nobody remembers that shit.
Nobody remembers fastball, but they're still like, yeah, I remember that song.
Yeah,
there's one guy out there going, I remember.
Yeah. And it's Leon.
That's my son.
Yeah. That's your son.
I do like the way this movie's going, man. You got one of the Estevez brothers or the Sheen brothers or whatever. Like, what's the deal behind those names? Like, I know you have Martin Sheen and he has a son, Charlie Sheen, and then Emilio Estevez.
Well, Sheen's real name is Martin Estevez.
It's actually Ramon Estevez.
Oh, yeah, you're right.
Ramon.
He's Mexican, which a lot of people forget.
Yeah. Well, it's hard to tell.
I know.
It really is.
He just went into the makeover machine where they just peeled his face off completely and put a new one
on. The only
on
way you could tell is that he's, 80 years old? He still wears pompadour hair.
Well, part of the problem is that everyone's like, seriously, a Mexican president? I don't think so. Yeah. I'm sorry.
But you know what's even more fucked up, though, is because Emilio Estevez's son always fucked me up, because even watching Repo Man, where he was playing a punk-ass white boy, I'm just like, he's a punk-ass white boy with a full-on Mexican name, Emilio Estevez?
That's what always pissed me off about them. Yeah. It's like, you know, okay, so all their names are Estevez, and not one of them looks Mexican.
No, you will never see them in the Mexican
Latino,
Hall of Fame.
Whatever you want to call
ever, because I don't think the Mexicans know that they're fucking Mexican at all.
Yeah, what, like, who, are they on the run from the cartel or something?
I have no idea.
Is that why they never talked to Emilio Estevez for that long?
I have no idea.
Fuck everything up for us.
But I'm just glad that fucking Emilio Estevez, fucking Mr. Repo Man, is actually doing something again.
Right, because there was a time Emilio Estevez, like, he seemed like that was a guy whose career was going to be around.
Fucking yeah.
Of the Brat Pack, he was one of the guys you were like, wow, that's one of the big guys. Him and Judd Nelson, they ain't going anywhere. A James Spader guy will never amount to anything. Remember those days?
Hey, man.
Well, I remember.
Actually, this goes back to that whole The Way thing. Except,
well, it was
like,
funny. You know. Yeah, I mean, you looked at...
I think he was doing fine until that Mighty Ducks money came in.
Yeah.
Well, you know, man, in the 80s, 90s, it was... Charlie Sheen just slowly just pushing his brother out the way. You know, shit. I got Hot Shots, Part 2. I got this baseball movie.
Hey, man, Platoon. I'm in fucking Platoon.
No, not
real
Part
movie.
2, but Part 2. Oh, Platoon? Yeah. Oh, yeah, he's in Platoon. Yeah.
Shit, he's like Ferris Bueller's sister.
Yeah.
Shit, he's got Wall Street every day. He's probably just calling up his brothers like, nah, what you got going on? Ah, you ain't got shit.
I think where they really fucked up is when Charlie Sheen was off for Maximum Overdrive, and he was doing Platoon, and fucking Emilio was like, I'll fucking do it. That's going to be a fucking hit and a half.
Emilio, work with Oliver Stone. Hey, how's that Brat Pack thing work? Oh, that's right. The 80s isn't happening anymore. All right, clang.
It's like, working for Stephen King on his first directed film. What could go wrong?
Yeah,
I'll tell you what can go wrong. Me being in that theater all by myself.
Now you got one brother whose career is just going down the shitter, and the other brother, his career is jump starting up again.
Yeah,
well,
yeah.
I don't know. I haven't seen the movie. Y'all tell me. The movie might be shitty.
This is the directorial debut, I believe.
No. He's directed movies before.
Has he done movies before?
I want to say he did. He did a Mikey Ducks movie too, I think.
Yeah.
Does that count as actually directing a film?
Yes.
but he directed something before that. I remember because he was like one of the first.
Oh, he did
people.
The garbage truck movie, right? Men at Work. Yeah, that's right.
Oh, that's right. Well, let's forget about that one as well.
did he really do that?
I like that movie. Yeah, I want to say he did.
I just remember his first movie, which came out in the 80s. It was called Wisdom.
Either way, this is a film by Emilio Estevez.
Anyway, he's back to direct.
By the way, he never did a Mighty Duck movie.
Oh, okay. My
Dan Coase, where you get your information from?
my brain. My Windows 95.
You might be curious to know, and I just found out myself, he did do some episodes of CSI and Cold Case.
Oh, man, everybody
see, those are equivalent of Mighty Duck movies.
I directed one of those
last
week.
Seriously, there are so many episodes of CSI that eventually they just come to your door and go, it's your turn. return.
I know it's like you're being audited.
Yeah, exactly. There's so many spinoffs. I mean, yeah, it was like what last weekend I was directing a sort of CSI Mall Cops.
Yeah, the guy just comes to your door and goes, yeah.
Oh shit!
I know.
I gotta go direct one. Of
I
those.
Think Corey's like, cat directed one of those fucking episodes.
It's like the Census Bureau. They come. How old are you? What are you? What's just, are you been here in the States long? Have you directed an episode of CSI yet? Well, you got to. Come on.
Yeah. All right. But for the sake of people not giving us another, do you realize it was actually 10 minutes before you even discussed mildly what this film was about in the vaguest terms?
We're tap dancing.
We're entertaining the kids right now.
This is an odd film, even for Estevez, and certainly not what I would have expected. Because really, this is kind of a philosophical journey film.
Yeah.
Really? And not the sort of thing you expect from a man, really, but...
I think you described it well as calling it the male eat, pray, love.
Yeah, but... and maybe it's because it's from the guy point of view, but I thought it did everything right that Eat, Pray, Love got so completely and terribly wrong.
Yeah.
What you have here is Emilio Estevez is estranged from his father, Martin Sheen. I don't have the character names in front of me. You have to excuse me. It's been actually a few weeks since we've seen this.
Martin Sheen is good enough. He speaks for himself.
Yeah, exactly. And it is one of these things where, you know, you got a dad who's successful in his practice as a dentist,
yeah,
who has a son who's middle-aged, who still doesn't know what he wants to do with his life.
Yeah,
he's like, hey, son, why don't you get a job and come work for me? Man, I don't have to do it. I ain't got to work for the man. I'm trying to be real.
Yeah, Martin Sheen's kind of a conservative, but not, you know, like
yeah, he's necessarily, not an asshole.
You know, like politically or anything, but he's definitely sort of like that whole, you need to find roots, son, type
old
of guy.
Old-fashioned.
Yeah, indeed, old-fashioned. And Emilio Estevez
is
the guy,
school
he's
is what the kids
obviously
say.
In his 40s, and he's still hitchhiking around Europe randomly looking for himself. And sure enough, on one of these journeys, Martin Sheen gets a phone call one time and one day and finds out that his son has died. He was hitchhiking from one point.
It's a famous walk that people do.
Yeah, it's a what do you call it when you do a religious
walkabout?
A pilgrimage.
It's a famous pilgrimage, and lots of people do it not even just for religious reasons. They do it just, you know, their own whatever spiritual journey.
We called it kung fu back in my day.
And as Martin Sheen goes to Italy to collect the body, he finds out about this thing and his son's reasoning for doing it. His son was killed by a freak storm early on in the path. And it's one of those things, like, even though Martin Sheen himself is not a terribly religious man, he decides that it will mean something to him on a personal level to take his son's ashes and do this voyage himself, this walking trip. So along the way, he meets a series of odd personality types that, unlike Eat, Pray, Love, for instance, where you just go from one to the other.
Yeah, just,
this is
just
building up a
whatever.
Cast of them that become the, you know, the backbone of this as we find all these people's different reasonings for wanting to do this, the very different reasonings for wanting to do this voyage.
Yeah, it's true. And probably the strength of the movie is this cast of characters that he picks up. Because you get this one big guy from Norway, I think. What's his name?
Lars? He's from Amsterdam.
From Amsterdam.
He stays high the whole time.
Yeah, he just likes to get high. And his reason for doing it is because he wants to lose weight.
Yeah.
I mean, and, you know, he's kind of the jolly guy. He's like whenever this guy is there, he shows up. You know, you like him. He's fun-loving. He's lovable. Mm-hmm. And he almost makes Martin Sheen more of a crank because he's kind of like... I kind of wanted to do this with my son, and you won't leave me alone.
Yeah, it's a personal journey for Martin Sheen.
Well, it seems like he wants to do it for personal reasons on his own anyway, and he keeps picking up like these Wizard of Oz type characters along the way.
It almost is, because you know, as you walk this, it goes on for days or even weeks, and along the way, there's people whose houses, you know, who like, hey, oh, you're some of the pilgrimage people, you know, come stay with us, and we'll feed you and put you up. So that, you know, the whole all these areas from Spain and every place they walk, they're already prepared for it. He stays in one place and he meets this woman, Deborah Carr Unger, who, you know, he's just kind of trying to be friendly to. Hey, how's it going? And she is a bitch to him right off the bat.
You were so mad. I was looking at
him. I was.
He's like, man, fuck this cunt. What the hell?
Yeah, she's like, shh. Why are you out here, old timer? And it was like, oh, I don't know. I was looking for the biggest cunt in the world. And guess what?
I just managed to walk right into it. I was wondering why there was an echo in here.
Hello. It's Tom Chiori and Sancho Panza.
And that will beg you, Dulcinea.
Buen Camino, fellow pilgrim.
Oi, Buen Camino. My name is Joost. I'm from Amsterdam.
Dutch, huh? Got any drugs?
Oh, I love this girl.
Wears off quick, I promise.
You know each other?
Sort of.
What are you looking to score?
Oh, something for sleep. I've had trouble sleeping for the past, I don't know, couple of years.
You folks mind doing this drug deal while we walk?
I got some Ambien. Or something stronger, if that's your pleasure.
Ha! I love this guy.
It wears off quick, I promise.
But, you know, she's going, you know, she wants to quit smoking.
I'm just picturing Empire Strikes Back. All of a sudden, this is no cave. Because he walks into the biggest cunt in the world.
later on, you pick up an Irish writer. What's that actor's name?
Oh,